The complete Twilight Zone scripts of Rod Serling, Gauntlet Press. I hope you will share my delight at the publication of these marvelous scripts, the hard-won pages that generated everything, the words on paper that were used to evoke what appeared upon the television screen. Verify for yourself that they serve not only as blueprints, but are also highly readable literary documents of great artistic power. Discover that, like fairy tales, these scripts tell universal truths. They are archetypal accounts of how the personality meets and overcomes its own dangers. They speak in the language of symbols directly to the soul. Notice that the stories appear to be timeless, to take place under the aspect of eternity, composed as the stories are of both the seen matter and the unseen spirit. They ask you to accept both the undeniable and the unbelievable at the same time. As Buck Houghton, the gifted producer of The Twilight Zone, said, the story must be impossible in the real world. A request at some point to suspend disbelief is a hallmark of the series. They are more metaphysical than religious. They are more spiritual than supernatural. They are more fantasy than science fiction. For as Ray Bradbury said, science fiction takes you up to the edge of the cliff. Fantasy kicks you over. In answering the age-old question, what if, Rod's stories exemplify the power of the dream and the magic of the wish. They are, in a word, surreal. As an art form, surrealism tries to banish the distinction between the real and the unreal to provide for an infinite expansion of reality. When Rod Serling created the Twilight Zone television series, he took a job working on the frontiers of the limitless, searching for a foolproof unity of opposites. To the mind of the surrealist, both the real and the imaginary can be equally real if, when reflected into each other, both realities make sense and mutually support each other to reveal a greater truth. If you can believe both realities simultaneously, your awareness of the paradoxical nature of the cosmos is intensified. You can come away from this glimpse of infinity changed. And with Rod Serling's highly developed moral compass pointing the way, usually changed for the better. Yes, surreal stories expand consciousness. They are wisdom fiction. The design for the format for the Twilight Zone television program itself is a major achievement, and the decision to use Rod Serling, the creator and chief architect of the project, as the host narrator, was inspired. The decision to pan down from the sky into the opening shot of each story, to begin each story with a strong teaser that would introduce a touch of strange that would intrigue the audience, and at the conclusion of the teaser to whip pan to Rod Serling within the scene itself, ready to comment upon what you have seen in a grim, tight-lipped way that was itself a promise to the viewer of wonders to come. All this was masterful, but it was the quality of the scripts themselves that would establish Rod Serling's The Twilight Zone as television literature. As you read Rod Serling's pages, consider this. Although they are compelling works of art in their own right, these scripts are merely the scaffolding used to build the television programs. To serve their purpose, the scripts had to be translated into different language of images and sounds to become those wonderful episodes you saw on TV. Remember, Rod was writing for the eyes of the producer and the director, for the actors, for the cameraman and the set designer. He was also writing for the technicians involved in lighting, sound, and wardrobe, and for the editor, who would have to refer back to the script to discover how best to fit together the footage supplied by the director. He was speaking to them in a stylized language he hoped they understood. With words on paper, Rod had to reach out and seize hold of his reader's imagination to awaken and arouse that reader's potential for creativity. Seeing the shows reminds us how wildly successful he proved to be. And isn't it significant, as you read these scripts, how much the words on the page evoke the clear memory of what you saw on the screen? Fortunately, for myself and for others, Rod could not write all of the scripts himself. Fortunately for Rod, however, before he came to town, there were two journeyman writers floating around writing movies and episodic television shows, as well as novels and Twilight Zone-type short stories. They were Charles Beaumont, The Hunger and Other Stories, The Intruder, and Richard Matheson, Third from the Sun, The Beardless Warriors. Rod accomplished his purpose by first buying several published short stories from these two to adapt, and then, later, hiring them to adapt the stories into television scripts. Both writers proved to be astonishingly prolific. Still, from time to time, Rod would run out of original story material for himself and would buy published stories from other writers, including Manly Wade Wellman, Marvin Petal, Lucille Fletcher, Lynn Venable, Paul Fairman, Madeline Champion, Louis Paget, Henry Kuttner and C.L. Moore, Jerome Bixby, Sam Rolfe, and myself to adapt. I was, eventually, like Matheson and Beaumont, allowed to adapt my own stories and thus able to join Earl Hamner Jr., Jerry Sowell, Ray Bradbury, Reginald Rose, E. Jack Newman, Montgomery Pittman, John Tomerlin, Bill Idelson, and John Furia in writing scripts for the show. Rod Serling and Buck Houghton gave me a hand in the game, for which I will be eternally grateful. In translating all of these scripts into films, producer Buck Houghton must not be overlooked. He shared a common vision with Rod Serling that kept the two men in total sync. We writers worked for Buck. It was often Buck who needed to be pleased with our work before Rod would even see it. But if Buck said he liked a verbal story idea, I found I could depend upon him to buy the story if I could work the kinks out of it. Like Buck Houghton, Charles Beaumont, Richard Matheson, Jerry Sowell, and Earl Hamner, Rod Serling had a concern for matters of character. He was interested in human morality. He strove to live up to an ideal standard he had set for himself that had very much to do with personal honor, honesty, sincerity, morality, dignity. A word you don't hear much is integrity. It can be detected in certain men who are much more interested in the great within and the state of their spirit than they are in the world out there. I cannot speak with any authority about Rod Serling. I barely knew the man, but I did encounter him a number of times and had an opportunity to take his measure. I knew him as a man who said what he meant and meant what he said, a man I could admire. He was a trim little colossus who got the attention of the press by standing off the Philistines. He was truculent, but very civilized. A well-spoken gentleman in a neat black suit, ever ready to publicly lift his strong, clear voice against censorship, bigotry, injustice, dishonesty, false pride, and low motives in high places. I loved the guy from afar, and even fancied that I knew what made him tick. I remember my last conversation with him. He asked me about the Liars Club, a kind of quiz show, with Rod as host, moderating between celebrity guests, competing with each other with outlandish explanations of the uses of unusual tools or apparatus. The lies were often ingenious, and sometimes the show got laughs, but was usually quite dismal. Rod asked me, "What do you think of me doing that show?" My first impulse was to remind him that he was too important to be wasted on such a trivial endeavor, as doubtless other voices of sanity had told him. I wanted to say, what is the current president of the Academy of Motion Picture Arts and Sciences doing on a lowbrow show like the Liars Club? But I saw something in his face of a boy trying to decide if he should run off to the circus or to stay safely at home. I told him that I believed that if he wanted to do the show, he should. He had years ahead of him in which to be serious. Little did I know how soon he'd leave us. Although, to this day, I expect to find him leaning against a suddenly fake-looking building, ready to tell me something damned interesting and thought-provoking in a tight-lipped, menacing way that will remind me that it's all a game, that existence is endless, and the universe but a bubble on the foam of time, with the human spirit always triumphant and love conquering all. The guy really had an influence on his times, and with these scripts will continue to mold minds and expand consciousness for some time to come. If, after reading these scripts, you find that you have developed a taste for what Bosley Crowther called photogenic fiction in his introduction to Rod Serling's Requiem for a Heavyweight, Bantam, I urge you to search out Richard Matheson's The Twilight Zone Scripts, Volume 1 and Volume 2, Edge Books, 2001, The Twilight Zone Scripts of Earl Hamner, Cumberland House, 2003, The Classic Scripts and Stories by Jerry Sowell, Bear Mountain Media, 2003, The Complete Twilight Zone Scripts of Charles Beaumont's, Volume 1 and Volume 2, Gauntlet Press, Forgotten Gems from the Twilight Zone, Gauntlet Press, and Twilight Zone Scripts and Stories, George Clayton Johnson, Streamline Pictures, 1996.